Hello and welcome back to LCA TV. My name is James Bromberger, and joining me on the couch now we have another interview that we've managed to squeeze in, Dave Chinner, who is the XFS co-maintainer.
Yep, that's right.
And for those who don't know, XFS is...
XFS is a Linux file system that originally came from Silicon Graphics, written almost at the same time that Linux first appeared on the scene back in 1993.
So we're talking it's 21 years old.
It's almost 20 years old. It actually, 21 possibly. I didn't actually look at the numbers. I should have in my
talk. The number goes up so high so quickly.
Yes.
So what sets XFS apart from other file systems?
It's originally designed for high-performance computing environments, so it was designed for scalability, really large lots. If you have to add several zeros to a number, that's where you'd use XFS. But these days, I guess you could say that what was a supercomputer 5 years ago
is,
well, almost, not quite, but that's what you're seeing in the server room these days. So a file system that was actually designed for supercomputers and the concurrency and the size and scale of them, that's what we're using for running our businesses these days. So it actually makes a lot of sense to take a file system that was designed for those sorts of situations for our current technologies.
But surely if it's 20 years old, there can't be anything happening with it now.
Well, you
could
say that.
Isn't it?
Yes.
Tell us what's new with it.
What's new? Well, the recent advances that we, or the recent changes we put in at metadata CRCs, we've been concentrating actually on reliability over the past couple of years. The scalability and the performance is there. It's kind of inherent in the architecture of it. So we haven't really had to do anything to make that work as it's intended. That's more a maintenance cost. But what's really limiting us these days is things like error detection and things when they fail, working out what failed, why it failed, the scale of the file systems. You know, when talking of hundreds of terabytes in a single file system, it's like trying to find a needle in a haystack when something goes wrong. So one of the things that we've been trying to do is make it easier to find that needle.
Right.
So to work out why something went wrong, automate the actual detection of errors so that we know about them before they actually cause problems for users and whatnot. So basically just trying to, well, make my life easier more than anything else because I'm the one that has to deal with those sorts of problems.
Absolutely. Now you say co-maintainer, how many people are co-maintaining that?
Just two of us.
Two of you.
The other maintainer is Ben Myers, and he works for Silicon Graphics, or SGI as they're now known.
Right.
Yeah.
And are you going to convince him to come to LCA next year?
I could try. I don't know how successful I'll be about it, because it is a long way from where he lives in Minneapolis.
Now, you've been to a couple of LCAs, and your accent, I believe you're Australian, aren't you?
Yes, I am.
Whereabouts are you based?
I live in a little town called Bulahdelah, about 2.5 hours north of Sydney.
Cool. Yeah. So New South Wales.
New South Wales,
and,
yeah.
And how many LCAs have you been to?
My first LCA was in 2007.
Right.
I've missed a couple since then for various reasons, but I try and make it every year. LCA is one of those conferences that nobody should miss.
It's obviously got a special place in my heart, but it's nice to see it move around. Do you think that's a challenge or a detriment or a good thing that LCA moves to?
No, I think that's a really good thing. LCA is different every year, and one of the things that can happen with a conference that is in the same place every year is it gets stale. And like, for example, this happened to the Ottawa Linux Symposium. That was back in the early 2000s. That was the go-to Linux conference that you had the kernel summit there every year and so on. And everybody kept going back to Ottawa, and it just got stale. Nobody wanted to go back there because it was the same thing every year. And what we've got here with LCA is that it is in a different place every year. It's always fresh. It's always in beautiful campuses, whether they be in Ballarat or here in Perth by the river, in Melbourne or Hobart. Even in New Zealand. It's refreshing to go and see a different city every year. Maybe talking to a lot of the same people because they all keep coming back as well. But it's really different because there's a lot of hobbyists and people that just have interests yes. outside of just what they do every day. And, you know, talk to people and, you know, oh, well, I just found out that there was a bunch of people really interested in cars and engine management systems and so on, which is kind of one of my hobbies.
Nice.
And so to come here and find a whole bunch of like-minded people that are doing things that I do as well in my spare time.
So we have these subcultures, I guess, then the car people, the rocketry yeah. people, the flying people.
Yeah, exactly, yeah.
All hardware hackers, I guess, at heart, and all trying to take it back to a Linux and open source ethos, I guess,
and I mean, to you know, one of the reasons that we work in open source is because we believe that this is the right way to do things. Mm. What I give to somebody else, they improve and give back to me, so I win from that.
Absolutely.
I mean, I think the success of Linux is a testament to the fact that this model works. Mm. And so we tend to apply it to everything else we do. I get frustrated by not being able to hack the engine management system in my race car. So what am I doing here but talking to people about how to hack an engine management system
Which
in a race car?
Which has been a hot topic for the last quarter or so as sort of exploits have come out for engine management systems.
Yes, and that's, partially that's because of the complexity of them. There is a lot more work in the embedded Linux world for things like the entertainment systems and so on that you get in the dashes of new cars and whatnot. There is now a lot of work to standardize that because rather than having every manufacturer roll their own distribution and their own little layers of software and so on, there's been a lot of work done over the past few years by the Linux Foundation and Linaro and foundations like that to get these things standardized, and so there's one code base that they're working on.
Not reinventing the wheel.
Exactly. All they do is they skin it to match whatever motif they want for it and make it look unique to the car. But underlying it, they're all running the same thing.
Which means it can be validated and tested.
Exactly. Yeah. And when you're talking about a car and something that's running 1.5 million lines of code, you kind of want to make sure that it works properly.
Absolutely, yeah. Absolutely. Look, what was your favourite thing of the session this year? I mean, we're almost at the end. We've had most of the sessions.
The favourite thing this year? I think what has stood out for me this year at LCA is that it's been a slightly different crowd of people. It's been a bit smaller, but I've noticed that there's a lot more students and people wanting to learn about Linux and how to get into perhaps becoming active developers. They're finding that the open source world is a big scary thing when you don't know anything about it. And so the kernel mini unconf, we had a whole session on how to start, how to get into becoming a kernel developer, how to contribute, and I've had those sorts of questions over and over again from people who like students here at this university and at Curtin across the river and whatnot. And so there's a lot of interest in how do we actually join and
barriers to entry.
Yeah. How do we get, you guys know so much about this, but we know nothing. How do we actually get your attention to help us learn this sort of thing? And so I think there's been, this LCA in particular, a much greater focus on learning how to, trying to spread knowledge on how to attract and involve new developers and to basically grow the community.
I think that's an important thing. I was looking around a couple of years ago at the size of the Linux user groups around Australia, and we were very much an aging population. It was those of us that were hacking away on stuff in the 90s and early noughties.
Yep.
We're now fast forward 10, 15 years from that, and attracting new people into the fold and making it an interesting place to create technology instead of consume technology.
Yeah, and I think what's happening is that in some ways technology is getting dumbed down so that it's more available to people. But in doing so, there's a wider base of people finding out that they're interested in how it actually works.
Yes.
And wanting to be able to change things and make an app do something that it doesn't currently do. And they're finding the only way to do that is to use open source software, because that's explicitly what we want people to do with it. Yeah.
Exactly.
So I think that you know, there is quite a different you know, feel about this year's LCA simply because of the people that are here and that have come this year.
It's such an amazing community of people that turn out.
Yeah, it's why I keep coming back.
Look, last question then. XFS, what exciting changes have you got coming up in the next 12 months or so? Anything big Apple items that you want to sort of grab and...
Well, I'm not sure what the big items are. There's a few ideas and a few things that we need to work towards, but one of the big new technologies that we really have to deal with in the file system world is this thing called persistent memory. And so, what you know, there's two things: there's persistent memory and a new type of drive that requires a different way of writing to them. And so, the optimizations that we need to make for these two different technologies are almost polar opposites. And so, working out how we can do things well in both situations, I think that's the big challenge. Making things go really fast and really efficiently and scale well for you know, persistent memory, which is going to be as fast as you know you can imagine. That's a real challenge, and I've got a few ideas for that. But on the other hand, the new drive technologies are actually potentially a lot slower than the existing hard drives.
Why is that?
It's because of the actual way they write. As the magnetic particles that store the bits of information on the disk get smaller and smaller and smaller, the read head and the write heads, you can only make them so small. And now they've got to the point where the bits on the spinning platters are much smaller than the reads and write heads. And so when you go to write a bit of disk, write a single bit of information on the disk, you can't just write a single bit. It affects all the bits around it. And so you have to write in a particular pattern that overlap different sections. And so you can't overwrite a bit of disk that's already got bits on it because you'll lose the data. And so it's much more difficult to manage how you locate the information on the drive. And as such, you're limited in the way you can write it. If you get it wrong, the drive firmware might be able to help and correct and avoid that problem, but in doing so, it's going to cause a massive performance slowdown. And so if you don't get everything perfectly right, the drives will be very, very slow. And it's just the nature of things getting smaller. And you know, we're talking about densities of information in the terabits a square centimeter. It's very, very dense, and the laws of physics are saying you can't get much smaller. And that's where we're hitting limits at the moment in the technologies to access those tiny, tiny, tiny little bits don't scale down to that we're getting down close to atomic level.
As always, we cannot defy the laws of physics.
Unless we're watching Star Trek.
Indeed, indeed. Look, Dave Chinnard, thank you very much for your time.
No problem.
Look forward to having you back again. Thank you, Dave.
Thank you.